good night. This is the Cutting Edge on RFM Radio Awadiyah next Wednesday. How you do? We're there again. Yes. Listen to Abdul Ibrahim, otherwise known as Dalla Brand, out of Cape Town, South Africa. Yeah, man, some of the greatest jazz musicians them come out of Cape Town, you know. Yes, Cape Town, right down the tip there, South Africa there. Between the Atlantic Ocean and the Indian Ocean, man, I tell you. Yeah, man, some of the greatest jazz musicians them come out of Cape Town, you know. Yes, Cape Town, right down the tip there, South Africa there. Between the Atlantic Ocean and the Indian Ocean, man, I tell you. You know, I hear up all the brethren and sisters them in Madagascar. The island over the other side of Africa, that's all. We want to yell up, you know. Yes, we know now this. Yeah, man. Sweet, 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 sweet music. Sweet music. Undeniable. Sweet music. Dalla Brand, Abdul Ibrahim, Cape Town, South Africa. So, we're going to move over to the west coast of Africa. One of my favorite artists of all times. Died years ago. We are there. Anna of performing with him in a village, in a place named the Shrine. Yeah, man, we perform with him, man, and him 24 wives. Yes, the man have 20, well, he had 24 wives when he was alive. Who we are talking about? Fella Ransom Kuti. Hey, Fella Ransom Kuti is a man. In time he make an album, you know, I just two tuned up on the album, you know. Yeah, when the man make album, man, they have so much things to say. Two tune, me see him stand up and perform three tune for one night. Three tune and perform. When I say three tune, it means from 11 o'clock to about 3 o'clock in the morning. And I'm not exaggerating. Three tune and perform. Everybody panels the stage take a solo. All them wife, them a dancer, so they have to get a solo dance. Him have to play him saxophone. And then play the piano, and then him have to talk on the rhythm, and then him have to sing on the rhythm. And that was just one tune. So just imagine that. And the people, them love him. There's a man who no perform without shirt neither, you know. Well, most of the time when you see him, he might perform without shirt, and when him there, yeah, him now wear clothes. Yeah, man, come out and I'm brief. And I blew him saxophone in my yard. May I tell you? Yeah, we don't know if anybody hear the news in Jamaica that them say Ghana is one of the fastest rising economy in the world. Yes? If not the fastest rising economy in the world. And them say the three top rising economy in the world is in Africa. It's English, my talk, you know. My talk. Well, observation is not for sale. This is the cutting edge. Yes, we're there with you. As we are saying, Africa. You know, we can't stop talking about Africa on this program now. And I said, no matter if you go over this, or if you come forward this, or if you come round this, or if you come back, so, you know. We say UNESCO, well, if you want to wonder what we did there, UNESCO invite me, I send kids. And, well, it's more than one place we go since we left here still, but UNESCO invite me to St. Kitts, Nevis, and the Rastafari community to celebrate African Liberation Day. It was such a wonderful thing to see the government involved in an African Liberation Day that them could have really sent for way for go by. It's not the first them sent for way still. You know, we've been there already. I remember one time me and Black Stalin, great Black Stalin. But I want to play the Black Stalin tune to Caribbean Unity. But it was such a heartwarming event to see the Rastafari community collaborating with UNESCO and the Ministry of Culture in Nevis. For bring I over there to celebrate African Liberation Day. So we want to help all the people, especially Eli. Well, Papa know Eli, and Eli lived there so few years like him in Jamaica, you know, but him come from over there. So Eli, give thanks, brethren. He was a wonderful host, man. Yeah, wonderful host, wonderful. You know, even Eli always called his program and I read poetry on it. So why you love Eli, why you love Carla, Yes, Carla, wonderful Oz, Antonio, even though you never did there. This way, but yes, and the Ministry of Culture in Anivis. I don't remember the other bridge in them name, you know. But there's so much bridge in. Yes. So why you look the one them for really host you over there so I make you feel at home. I really want to bring back two monkey, but I forgot you too much problem. Monkey while over there, you know. Yeah, monkey while up and down the street. It's like how we have donkey and all them something up on the road and goat. In our same kids, them have monkey. We are telling you, monkey. We didn't see more monkey the first time. The second time we go to see more monkey still, but them say, anyway, the fool them, they are the monkey there, you know. Anyway, the fool the monkey there. So, yeah, man, we really feel good. Give thanks for that. Okay, so back to the music. We want to play this tune for my sister in Jamaica who work at IRFM, program director, Cabo. I don't know if you're asleep, but you know, so every time I play that tune, I'm going to play it for you. Because I know so that tune I get your name from. You understand? The first name, Cabo. Names means sacred rock. It's an Ethiopian word, means sacred rock. So I want to play this tune for the sacred rock of IRFM. This is the cutting edge on IRFM today with you. Here we go. May I tell you, say, if somebody tell me, say, the cutting edge is not going to last so long, I'd tell them, say, I'm mad because anytime we just start a program, the amount of people want to come off of the radio. The amount of people we want to come off of the radio. But guess what? It's still there after 20 odd years, you know, about 27 years. It's there, so, but we want to heal up Cabo because, you know, all we are going, she have fair program where people listen to it religiously. And she's the one who's responsible for all the what you hear upon the radio and the programming, what you hear, and the structure and all these things. And we see she kind of direct the station in a way where, even though she's not Rasta, but Rasta have an element of voice upon this radio station now. And even that I come from Carl Young from them days there, where Carl Young, Marcus Garvey celebration, one of them hallmark festivals. Well, I call it festival now, but we see how the station move with people. First of all, the reggae thing was a no-no for most people. To have Jamaican music a play upon a radio station so much was a no-no, because I remember when them used to play, on Sunday, them used to play pure gospel music and classical music. And IRFM come and broke that down and play Jamaican music. Now we hear every Sunday, any station you turn pan now, you hear all this. Bob Clark program was the first program of that kind. But then, when we look upon the direction where IRFM take over the years, a people connection, why Ellis Kelly, why you love Ellis Kelly? Because you have certain program where it's like stamp indelibly, you know, the art of the people there. When them say IRFM, when them say IRFM, you hear them mention certain program. But the radio station take a direction where not just reggae music now, but a kind of roots cultural expression that is defined through Rastafari, even though Cabo don't declare herself Rastafari, she declares herself Pan-Africanist. But you can see how the radio station focus. I And some people that say, but too much Africa this, too much Selassie this, too much Rasta this, I don't think. But guess what? It is still the number one real station. In all of the whole heap of Africa this and Pan-African this and not like politician this and preacher this and that. It is still the number one radio station because it connect to the people. It connect to the people. There was a time when no advertisement was on this program. For years, no advertisement ever upon the program. Now, me have a ball. There's too much advertisement upon the program. And I can't do what I hear in them fields there. When you see so much advertisement by your program, especially them who was a night, it means the people who buy the advertisement feel them product will sell because people are listening to the program. That is what them tell me. So why you love Cabo again? Because with all of my antics and my this and this and that, she never yet come to me and say, me I say too much of that, what may I say that for? That I have no relevance in that or nothing. Me and I sit in and I said, that I want to come and I want to do that. And she said, well, why you shouldn't do that? He's a man, I agree with everybody, everything. He's the easiest person to get hard with. Especially Yasso. Because I know my intention. But she never yet come and say, you talk too much about this or you talk too much about that. And all the little antics them when we go out with now the day, it's still allowed with all the juxtaposing of words. We mean one thing, but I say the other thing. Because we know that we can't say certain things. We are another person that it said out there, but two of them can't really gear it towards a certain thinking and thought. It's easy to forget where we did. Because nobody can, the broadcasting commission can't come to you and say this and say that. So when we look at that, when we say Cardell, we say, Cardell, when we know you're Cardell, we say, boy, it's how you say the things, That is really what people don't know, that is how you say things. When you say certain things certain way, you get caught. So we have developed a way to say things on the radio that don't put no hole in the pocket at IRFM. Because that's the first thing Mr. Young said to me. Mr. Young said, Mota, just nobody listen to what them I say. I just do what I do as long as you don't put no hole in my pocket. And at 20 years with there, I know I will not put no hole in my pocket yet. I will still say what I say. So I yell up IRFM should be a people station. Other station that talk about people station. This is what you call a people station. It cater for the well, I don't want to say the lowest person on the road, but the person with nobody now even check for on the road, listen to IRFM. Because I'm afraid to see some man attack to me when I cast up all my car. Some man where a road him live, a street side him live. And he might tell me when I did attack about upon the stepping razor and upon the cutting edge. And me, I say, what? When you get radio from him, say, just cock up at one place and your radio pump out the place. At any given night, no, you go through some hills and valleys in Jamaica. Listen to it, tell me which station them I listen to. IRFM. So we really give thanks. So he's a part of that forward movement. Because the only radio station me know where from in the 90s people have got Africa and have broadcast from Africa. I don't know no other radio station in Jamaica we have them on the ear broadcaster in Africa I do the program from Africa. As a matter of fact, I don't know another radio station we broadcast from anywhere in the world. Unless them do a little link up, which is a normal thing for radio station though. But to take a radio station and carry it go in Africa and I talk about the door of return where you can't hear the sights and the sounds. You hear the sights. It's an achievement in itself. Because a lot of times people they believe say Africa are one weird place where it's not touchable. Because people hear about Africa, they think about some weird, far, weird place. I say, no, sir. Them places that IRFM bring Africa near to the people them. That the people them can have a little hint and move the little stereotype argument about Africa out of the minds of the people them. That even if them no want go there, even if them no like there, but them hear people who go there and hear people who broadcast from there. Which to me, as simple as it may be to maybe somebody else, is one of the achievements that I can't really forget in my life. You know, say, even if I left here so I'm gone, it's one of my life achievements. They say, imagine me there in Africa, and me had a 4 hours program in Africa, straight back to Jamaica, live. No, little 10 minutes broadcast, 4 hours. I don't know no other radio station in Jamaica will do that. As a matter of fact, I don't know no other station in the Caribbean. I don't know no other radio station in the Caribbean will do that. The reason why I talk so, and I reminisce so, is because my day in that place, you know, me live here, and I come back, and I live here, and again, you know, I hope people don't know, so I live here, 2 times I live here, you know, and come back. And me hear how people react to even that program here. Me hear them react to it. Certain places where Jamaica, you only know, say Jamaican there. When I'm here, so we hear them react to the program. And me, I say, what? Serious thing this? That a little real estate channel I send and can garner so much attention out there. You know, so promoters listen to IRFM in Europe to find out who they want to book for the next festival. Yeah, man. Promoters listen to IRFM to find out, say, wait, I hear that youth there, I get play, you know. And it get them interested, and I go up on YouTube, go listen to their music more. Yeah? Me know that as a fact. And in a dream up business, me know that as a fact. A radio, I mean, promoters in Europe listen to IRFM to find out the next talent for them should have bring to Europe during the summer. It's not just joke business. Because we out there, we not just radio person, we's artists too. And we go out there, go perform too. So, IRFM play a great, it can go on in a way where no radio station, you know what I'm saying, it go where no radio station has ever gone before, where it exceeded its expectations. And to see that it is still number one in all of the this and the that. You know, we see the outside link up them when no other radio station not. When I say a radio station go on African celebration or a black celebration. Them not do it. Them spend like 10 minutes a link up with such and such a place. Some people them who come here or something, but them not associate themselves with the masses of the people them and the downtrodden of the people them. Because them feel that them people there now go make them radio station popular. And they don't know so the majority in the people in Jamaica is not rich people. It's normal people who are hear themselves on the radio station. You think it's the first time you could, you think, I call me a talk on radio. You think it's the first time you could talk on a radio station, so you're mad. You think first time you could attack on a radio station like how me attack, that's all now. Man, come in here and tell you, say, look here, you do have no job the next day. But RFM come to the people them. You talk to the people them. Me never get no journalist education. But we know, say, if you talk normal, like how you usually talk, the people them will listen to you. Take it personal and feel so you're talking to them and with them and for them. So that is what it is all about. When you can listen to a radio and hear the person talking with you, for you. And that is what this station offer. So even if we're not there again, we are saying, big up IRFM, the number one radio station in the Caribbean, because it has taken broadcasting where no other radio station has ever gone before. And to see that this is not BBC, not CNN, not Fox. It is a music station that infuses interactive conversations, our opinions, that can be related. Even if you don't agree with Muta Baruka and you have no people who don't agree with Muta, but guess what? Them still listen because it stirs them imagination, it stirs them, it make them think. It make them know that there's not one way to look at things, there's other ways to look at it. And whether you want to feel say we're wrong or we're right, it make you think, and that is what we are all about, to awaken the conscience and the consciousness of the people. This is the cutting edge. We're going into Ethiopia again. Malaika, Angel. You have to tell me now, which other radio station carry the people them to celebrate Marcus Garvey's birthday in a festival spirit? Not just for sure, or regurgitate different videos span television or different audios span radio, but to go out amongst the people them and set up place to celebrate Marcus Garvey, to bring speakers from all over the world to talk to the people them as it relates to them Africanness. Which are a radio station put them chuck upon the road, not for music, but for lobbying, for advocacy, for advocate for Rasta, Carroll Garden. Remember that famous move from War Theater go up to Mandela Park with me and Cabo de Pantapa, the chuck, straight up. And the amount of people, not to mention the Paul Bogle, which other station put them workers on the road for honor Paul Bogle and the struggle of Paul Bogle and advocate and lobby, not just for say it, but for go upon the road with all of his machinery to get involved. The Marcus Garvey bus will change because of the advocacy. You know what I mean? Show me them. That is why IRFM is the number one. Because you have a group of people that say we're not scared. Because it's not a government-controlled radio station where you can tell the people them how to program them things. All you can do is say you don't like the radio station. But there's always lobbying and advocacy going on, because there's so much things that we need for really correct, that you can't just have the mic in front of you and a big place like this and don't tell yourself, say, you have to, at least use the media and the medium by which you are given to really see what you can do to alleviate a whole heap of these stigma and stench that surrounds certain things, especially Africa and the ideas of Africa. So, we don't talk about IRFM for the night, you know. We are going forward to normal programming. So, here we go. We're going to start over the studio, you know. Yes. African music, sweet. Yes, sweet. But we don't get exposed to it because we're so near to America. So, most of our consciousness about music come from the Billboard charts them in America. You understand? So, anywhere that take over, you know, say the culture, the people, them, the indigenous culture, the people, them get lost. Yeah. Even in Africa, too. Because if you look how the youth, them are behaving in Africa, the same way they are behaving in Jamaica, yeah. Because the Americanization of them culture is so deep and embedded and entrenched right now that the indigenous culture get lost. Yes. Yeah, we're there with you up on the cutting edge. Go through the pieces as usual. While you let the people them who sit down and listen to it, who set up them food and sew clothes, who are doing them carpentry work, make furniture. All the gunman them who sit down there wait if you get late. Who say something interesting that you don't everybody go out there again. Man tell me that already too. Why some things that people tell me, that part of the program about, you know, man tell me, say, Muta, I tell the truth, you know, you see somewhere out the last night, you know, cause me you talk some things by the way that we could leave it. And you know, some of them are dead, you know, yes, because them never listen, them never sit down the next week and I listen. And them go out there and get killed. Like, whole heap of the youth, them here right now. You can imagine that, man. Jamaica is like a killing field. Me, I tell you the truth, you know. You see, when you're out there and hear the news in Jamaica, it sound a weird, you know. Me, I tell you, you know. You see, look at the hotel room, you know. And I go through my WhatsApp, you know, and I say, but wait. Because I know, say, you have people we live a foreign land. When I'm looking at them WhatsApp, I really clean and foreign. I hear the news are foreign. They must say, really, that are going. I mean, if you remember, say, 2.7 million people in Jamaica living at this thing, yeah? And some of we is quite happy. Some of we is quite freaking out about what is going on. But we live here. You understand? It's like, in America, you don't know, when a little youth, I go run going to school and shoot up a place or in a nightclub. You don't know in France when a man will walk in the place and bomb up the place. I drive a bus through a crowd. You walk in a land and I don't know when a guy got just stab up the place like what I'm doing in Japan the other day. So, 6 or 1.5 dozen are the other. 6 or 1.5 dozen are the other. But you see, when you're Jamaican and you hear the news, I come out of Jamaica. Trust me, it's not so nice at all. It's not so nice. This is the cutting edge. Yes, this is the cutting edge. I want to tell you about a function that will be held tomorrow. Well, no, on the 12th yet, so tomorrow, yes. It will be held at the Vera Moody Concert Hall, Edna Manley College of the Visual and Performing Arts. And this is entitled Women Who Walk with Water. A performance and conversation on climate change and gender. Thursday, tomorrow at 7:30 p.m. at the Vera Moody Concert Hall, Edna Manley College at the Visual and Performing Arts. And it will be featuring poets, Jean Binta Breeze. I don't know if I can pronounce this. Najeka Barnes, Jean Binta Breeze, Aziko Simba Mbala, and Carol Miller. And Lakatko will be there. So this is a how much o'clock it starts? 7:30. Well, if I can make it in time. I would love to go there. I would love to. And the admission is free. Whenever I have seen a part there. The admission is free. Yes. Women who walk with water. A performance and conversation and climate change and gender. This is the cutting edge. Yes, may I tell you, Lee Scratch Perryman, ball of fire. Okay, so you're asking now. Anyway, in the world, in Jamaica, the time is 12 midnight. Yes, and speaking of Child Month, we need to play this, you know, we need to play this, because clip here. Yes, Child Month. Here we go.
iPads and other devices are called tablets because they belong on tables. They are tested 20 centimeters away from that big guy that I showed you before. 20 centimeters away. They are not approved to be held in the laps of little children, although millions of kids are having them now in schools, because the people involved in educational technology and those involved in public health research are not talking to one another. Because if they were, they would understand that you're giving children a two-way microwave radiating device. And if you must give them such a device for learning purposes, put it on airplane mode so that it's not sending and receiving signals as it does otherwise. Now, this is some new modeling, again, that we've developed with colleagues in Brazil. And we can share with you how we've done it. We first start out with the MRI and create the model with 1 millimeter voxels. And this is quite a bit of work goes into creating this. And here is what it looks like after a period of 6 minutes. That's really not as bad as it might look, because you see the red area only gets partway through the eye of the adult, right? The one that we're really concerned about is this one with the young child. And this is a three-year-old brain that we modeled. And you see that by the end of that six-minute call, the peak radiation, yellow and red, is getting all the way into almost both eyes. And again, it's one call, and it's not going to kill anybody. It may not cause any biological effect whatsoever for one call or two calls or three calls. But the question is, what's the cumulative impact of this kind of exposure? How do we evaluate it? And I want to show you an example of some of the work that we are doing now that I'm releasing here for the first time. And this is a modeled microwave radiation dose of a six-year-old with greater levels to the frontal and temporal lobes, eyes and cheek. And watch this here. Now, yellow, white, and red are the hottest, all right? And if you look carefully, you will see it's going into the eye, the nose. Do it again, just so you'll get to see it. And partly into the brainstem. Now, that's just showing you that there's going to be some exposure into that area of a young head. It doesn't tell you that there's any biological effect, right? Now, the next slide is going to show you something that might be of interest to students and faculty here. And that has to do with exposure to the reproductive organs. We call them the gonads. I think you say the testicles and bone marrow. And look here at the radiation as it gets into the groin area. And that's just from having a mobile phone modeled into the pocket. And this, again, is based on normalized SAR with a dipole antenna. Now, the breast. The breast is mostly fat, contains a lot of fluid. Things that contain fat and fluid cook faster in the microwave oven. Now, a cell phone can't cook anything, right? Mobile phones do not pop popcorn. That was a fraud. They don't make any heat that we know of, otherwise they wouldn't be permitted. But they do go through things that contain fat and fluid. And We are now working an environmental health trust with scientists at the University of California, San Francisco, scientists at formerly the president of the American Cancer Society of California, because we are seeing women who keep cell phones in their bras. Has anyone seen a woman put a cell phone in her bra? Hands up, please. Please tell them you've heard now why they shouldn't do that. And here I want to show you our first case report from 2009, and we now have many more. This was a Chinese-American woman, who used her cell phone 4 hours a day in her bra for 10 years while she was driving. Now, and you drive with a phone on your body. The phone is smart. It's going to go from one tower to another, and it's going to say, here I am, where are you, here I am. And it's going to be going to max power each time it moves from one cell tower to another. And there it was right next to her chest. And the tumors that developed right under the antenna of the phone. Unusual tumors. But in the meantime, people have a right to know how you can minimize exposure. And again, I think this information is available on our website, will be available on yours. Remember, if you have to give a phone to a child, put it on airplane mode. And think about this. That microwave oven, it works because there's a metal box around the microwave signal. And the signal pings all over the place. Next time you get into an elevator or a train for any length of time, put your phone on airplane mode. Otherwise, that signal is going all over the place, magnifying and coming back. Keep the mobile phone away from you when it's on and you are asleep. Now, it takes a village to do a lot of things. These are some of the people whose materials I've used today with their permission, and I can't read this list to you, but I want you to know that I feel really honored to be working with some of the most talented people in the world on this issue, and they have given me permission to share these materials with you. And I leave you with this thought from Albert Einstein. The world is not dangerous because of those who do harm, but because of those who look at it without doing anything. So, thank you.
Yes, serious reasoning about the iPad and his social talk, because when you're going on a plane, yeah, them shouts say either you lock off your telephone, cell phone, or put it by airplane mode. Because when they're by airplane mode, it now transmit like how microwave oven transmit. We want to continue it in the same vein. Here you go.
The tycoons of social media have to stop pretending that they're friendly nerd gods building a better world and admit they're just tobacco farmers in t-shirts selling an addictive product to children. Because let's face it, checking your likes is the new smoking. Philip Morris just wanted your lungs. The App Store wants your soul.
There are 2 billion people, more than 2 billion people on Facebook. That's more than the number, it's about the number of notional followers of Christianity. People check their phones 150 times a day, the millennial sort of audience. And so if you think about it, from the moment you wake up, it's like you're jacked in to this environment. And thoughts start streaming into your head, designed by a few technology companies.
What we find is the typical person checks their phone every 15 minutes or less. And half of the time they check their phone, there's no alert, no notification. It's coming from inside their head telling them, gee, I haven't checked in Facebook in a while. I haven't checked on this Twitter feed for a while. I wonder if somebody commented on my Instagram post. That then generates cortisol, and it starts to make you anxious. And eventually your goal is to get rid of that anxiety, so you check in.
And apparently we feel stressed when we can't get our phone or when our battery is about to die. You probably know this feeling. And a research done in Australia among 3,000 people under the age of 30 found that 9 out of every 10 admit to feel this anxiety while having his battery dying.
Steve Jobs revolutionized the entire world with the iPhone. And he never let his children use it. Because he did not want them dependent on technology.
Right now, an infant is getting their first laptop that's soft and squishy and makes noise. Right now, a child is being born online and being favorited and retweeted.
The hypergenerational segregation of our time is bizarre, unhealthy, and historically unprecedented. You've never seen the like of people sitting at a table in a restaurant not talking to each other because they're texting and using their Facebook and Instagram and Twitter, and they are at the table and don't even know each other. In the house and can't even talk to each other. And the pressure that's on us to be like everybody else is so great that everybody tries to live like they're in a reality show.
As a culture, we don't have enough in common anymore. And that's because the internet, which was supposed to unite the world, has become too adept at serving us personalized content. Do you know what I saw on Yahoo's front page this morning? No, you don't, because mine isn't the same as yours. People get news feeds now that just spit back customized stories based on what we've clicked on in the past.
We are great consumers, but poor producers. We will buy what we can't afford with money that we don't have to impress people we don't even know, trying to be like everybody else. Get off of Facebook and put your face in a book.
Right now, a teenager is photoshopping their selfie because as a society, we're telling them they're not good enough. Right now, influencers encourage narcissism without knowing the breadth and depth of their impact on their audiences. Right now, 40,000 spectators are in an Olympic football arena watching a competitive esports competition. Because this is this generation's football match.
There's always this narrative that technology is neutral and it's up to us to choose how we use it. This is just not true.
Technology is not neutral.
It's not neutral. They want you to use it in particular ways and for long periods of time because that's how they make their money.
You don't realize it, but you are being programmed. It was unintentional. But now you got to decide how much you're willing to give up, how much of your intellectual independence. If you feed the beast, that beast will destroy you. If you push back on it, you have a chance to control it and rein it in. And it is a point in time where people need to hard break from some of these tools and the things that you rely on. The short-term dopamine-driven feedback loops that we have created are destroying how society works. No civil discourse, no cooperation, misinformation, mistruth. And it's not an American problem. This is not about Russian ads. This is a global problem.
I challenge everyone to try going 1 week without social media.
Don't let your phone and social media control you.
Listening? Are you listening? You know, they say this is Child Month. Who more than the children them is hooked on this social media, laptop, cell phone, iPad thing? And I say people give them little baby. This little thing in them hand for watch games pan or watch cartoon pan because them don't want the baby cry. So this is a part of the I don't want to take up the child, I don't want to take responsibility, so I can go and do something else. Meanwhile, the little rectangular box look about my child. Serious thing. We're going to continue. We're going to continue.
giving our kids free access to social media and phones at young ages. They are not ready for it. Their minds cannot cope with the dopamine. They can only have it up to a certain hour, and you take it away. They're children. You can take the phone away. We've got to intervene as parents. But as companies, we now have to deal with the influx of kids that are coming into our companies with addiction. Watch. I see it all the time. Walk through any office. You'll see the older employees have their phones on the sides of their computers as they're working. You'll see the youngest employees have their phones face up in front of their keyboards between their arms as they're working. And this is how they work. And the science is alarming. They did experiments on mice where they did the multitasking. They put flashing lights to mimic going from the computer to the cell phone, the computer to the cell phone to the TV. The mice that were exposed to the changing lights, it took them 3 times longer to solve a maze than the mice that weren't, and the damage was permanent. There is a subconscious reaction to these devices when we use them, okay? What if I were to hold my phone while I'm talking to you? I'm not checking it, it's not buzzing, it's not beeping. I'm nothing, I'm just holding it. Do you feel at this moment that you are the most important thing to me right now? No, you do not. Because there is a subconscious reaction we have to the device. When it is out, it makes the people around us feel that they are less important. So when we're walking down the halls in our offices and somebody says, hey boss, can I ask you a question? You go, sure, what's on your mind? We've just told them they're not that important. Or we can go, sure, what's on your mind? And if you don't have a pocket, find a shelf, put it on the shelf, come back and say, sure, what's on your mind? When we show up to a meeting, or a lunch, or a dinner, with our colleagues, our clients, or our friends, or our families, and we put the phone on the table, we have announced to everyone in the room that they are not that important to us. And by the way, putting the phone upside down is not more polite. My favorite one is when the meeting or at a lunch with someone, that the phone will ring and the caller ID will pop up and they will go, I'm not going to get it. Oh, so magnanimous. Lucky to eat with you today. Or they could just put the damn thing away. You can tell how addicted we are. When somebody pulls out their phone when you're with them, how uncomfortable does that make us feel? You're walking down the street with someone, they pull their phone out. We feel stupid, so what do? We pull our phones out. We're so addicted. Somebody goes to the bathroom when we're at dinner, and what do we have to sit there by ourselves? God forbid we should look around the room for 5 minutes. We pull our phones out. Meetings. Awful. What do we do when a meeting happens, right? Everybody's sitting waiting for the meeting to start. Bob's running a few minutes late. Bob's here? Okay, start the meeting. Do you know when relationships are built? All that in-between time.
This is the cutting edge on IRFM. I got through the pieces. You know, that cell phone thing there, you know, I mean, it's addiction. Rapidus admit it. Say, them invent something else, forget we hook. And it's an addiction. It is an addiction. It's still a tour, may I tell you. What call you Rai? In Paris, man. Okay. I can work with that one now. I can work with the last one now. I will play it already. Yeah, I will play it already. Phone addiction. It's a serious thing. All I will get up on it, boy. May I tell you, man. What do they think of next? No, you see them have the cell phone. You see them have the phone where you can put in your hand miggle. I mean, like, inject it in your hand miggle. Yes, they inject it in your hand miggle. And when it ring, the whole body ring. May I tell you? I mean, this is something where they're out there right now, you know. It's not something where in a futuristic movie. It's something where out there right now. You can put this, you can inject the cell phone inside of you and talk without anything in your hand. You think we say invention, yes? Wait till 20 years down the line. Yes, as one out of England, African children, yes, this is the cutting edge, yes, Eel.
Eel Muta.
What, man?
What? Yes, nice. That phone thing is something else, see?
Yeah, it come like the news, devil man.
No, me tell you things really, really. And I do have to ask, there's no way you gonna make your body become a phone.
No, sir. You see it?
Them thing must have some serious health consequences.
Of course.
Yes, the wheel summit and that type of thing. Eh?
Yeah, well, apart from the food, no, it's electronics plant in your skin.
Yes.
Yeah, them have sensory. You know, so them have some company now where there, it's not mandatory, but you have a whole heap of workers do it. When the implant is chipping at you, and you can move around without key. If you want to go through a door, you just put your finger over it and it go. And if you want to go, all sorts of things. Let me have care now where you have no key. You know, it's like your body start the care. You know, it's like, wow.
No, I see them having some serious health consequences, that type of thing and all. Facial recognition to go to places. You don't need no book or no card. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
No. It's a Frankenstein type of business.
You might get rid of the human spirit out of the whole thing now, you know?
IT. Yes. It's not everything that is new is good, as you and I know.
Yeah.
It's not every technology is good, because technology is either positive or negative, you know?
Yeah.
Because, for example, the atomic bomb, that was technology, yes, but to murder more and more people.
Yeah. Well, your man
is not every form of technology is must embrace or supported, because technology can either be positive or negative, depending on who created it and for what reason. But I see Sizzler Kalonji under attack again, because 2 years straight, you know that reggae and the river thing in California in the state.
Yeah, maybe about that. So the man said, no, know him.
Yes.
How that go? Come here, say the promoter say him don't know who named Sizzler Kalonji.
No, that could not be the case, because he was the headliner in, I think, 2015 or 2016.
So what happened this time? I can't hear a little about it, you know. What happened this time?
But what they said this time is that even though he was the headliner in either 2015 or 2016, they said that commander attack by the homosexuals in California and so on, because of statement that he made after some interview thing, after Rebel Salute, so about homosexuality.
Oh, yeah. I remember that interview there, yeah.
Yeah, so that is what they're using, because he said that. But how I see it, it shows intolerance, because in saying that, Sizzler did not say to kill or attack homosexuals.
He merely
stated that their homosexual lifestyle is wrong. Mm-hmm. And it got to show that the homosexuals themselves, while claiming that people are intolerant of them, they are intolerant of people who do not agree with them.
Yeah.
And this is what I don't like. They're claiming that people are intolerant of them, but they are intolerant. They don't want anyone to object to their lifestyle.
Yeah. Well, it's not going to promote now, you know. Everywhere you go now, it's not going to get promoted now, you know.
And they mentioned Queen Ifrika, who was pulled from being the headliner in New York just a few years ago at a show in New York at the Amazura, because of her stance in rejecting their lifestyle.
Yeah.
So it is a revival of this attack against reggae artists who have the right to say,
to disagree,
what lifestyle that they approve of and what they disapprove of.
Yeah, you have the right to disagree, man.
Yes, you know, and that's why I like the Queen Ifrika song, Freedom of Expression, which was about the same thing.
Yeah.
No, people was have a right, man. No, I'm fine in the thing with homosexuals. I mean, I've never accepted I've never advocated killing people who are homosexual and that type of thing. And I don't use this word gays because that's a camouflage term, because we know gay mean happy and that type of thing. You know what I mean? Tell it just like it is homosexual. Whether them having sex, proficient sex, whether them males or females. I have never advocated, nor of you and many other people, that we should attack homosexuals or we
should kill homosexuals.
We have a right, those of we who say that this is wrong practice.
Yeah.
And when I say wrong practice, it has nothing to do with Christianity, because in our original African culture, this is practice which is considered to be wrong with our original African culture.
Yeah.
You know?
A whole heap of African tribes don't even know that something like that exists.
Huh?
A whole heap of African tribes don't even know that something like that exists.
Precisely. And even within the culture of that thing, it is considered totally wrong in the 42 commandments there from Kemet and so on. One of them says that this is wrong practice.
Mm.
You know?
Definitely,
you know? And I just have to just remember great brethren Castro Brown, who passed away on the 11th, you know, of May, and he's supposed to be buried in Jamaica sometime next month, you know.
Oh, they might bring him forward, don't you?
Where he's from.
They might bring him forward, don't you?
Nanaland, where they call Portland, you know, after the Duke of Portland. Okay. But I call it Nanaland after our Queen Mother, Nana, of the freedom fighting people as you know, you know.
So and, I see your lady look like she have to go leave, you know.
Oh, Teresa, me.
Yeah.
You don't see how she's crying. She's crying more than the River Thames. And serve her right, because she was not crying when she created a racist environment, which led to a lot of our people being deported. And also some of, there's a brother from Jamaica who lived and worked here for years who was denied cancer treatment, because he couldn't prove that he had documents to be in the country, despite working for many, many years, most of his life in this country. You know, she wasn't crying then. When people have to go to food banks, she wasn't crying. She's only crying because she has to give up this job. And she's the one as home minister. I mean, the home office, when she was in charge of the home office, who created this racist environment that has led to increased racist attacks on our people and all buses going around saying, you know, people must be deported if they're illegal and that type of thing. And with the austerity which has affected the vast majority of people, and Grenfell Towers, where a lot of the people died in Ladbroke Grove were from our race or from low-income families who died. She never expressed any tears, shed any tears for them. So we have no sympathy for her tears. Absolutely none for Teresa May. You know, good riddance. And of course, she's not the only one, because she belongs to that clique who scapegoat people, you know, who are African and otherwise, who are not European. In terms of racist victimization and that type of thing, you know. And as you know, the reggae queens, because I don't call them reggae girls, they will be in France for the World Cup for next month. Hello? Yes. Hello?
Yeah, something I go wrong with you. Yes, sorry.
Something.
You hear me now, right?
Can you hear me?
Yeah, I hear you. You hear me now.
Yeah. Yes, man. They played Scotland, the Scottish female side, and they lost 3-2 after scoring, you know what I mean? But bad passing by the Jamaican sisters, man, you know. Mad, you know, the pass.
I was asking you, I was asking you, what, who you think going to be the next Prime Minister of England after me?
You know that it might be, because there are now 11 contenders. Mm. It might be this guy called Gove.
Who?
Gove.
Gove,
yes.
Okay.
It might be him. He was the one who, the last time, was supporting Boris Johnson to be the Prime Minister. And then he switched and went for the position himself.
Okay.
Which was considered a betrayal by a lot of people because he was pushing for Boris Johnson to be the Prime Minister, and people said that encouraged by his wife, who said, you go for it to be the Prime Minister instead of Boris Johnson.
Mm.
But I definitely, and a lot of people don't like the idea of Boris Johnson being any Prime Minister, because he has a track record in terms of racist comments that he has made in the past, and that type of thing, you know.
Okay.
And as foreign secretary, he has been a disaster.
Yeah.
Boris Johnson. Yes. You know.
Well,
and he, incidentally, he was born in the USA, you know.
Oh, yeah.
Boris Johnson.
Well, the part of them, I got to take with the people them land and I go like a film one and then I talk with the people them are alien.
Exactly. Mm. Exactly. For real. Yeah. You know. But right now, what usually happens, you know, is that in terms of the next Prime Minister situation, same thing it was with Margaret Thatcher, John Major, John people. A lot of times, the so-called upfront ones who people think might become the Prime Minister is usually someone who is not in the running, so to speak, that usually emerge as what them call as a compromise candidate, you know.
Usually
it's not who people think might become Prime Minister, become a Prime Minister. In a lot of cases, this is what happens. But right now, you know, they're putting each other's throat because they want to get into the Prime Minister role. But guess what happened? Whichever one of them becomes Prime Minister, they're facing the same Brexit problem that Theresa May has. Because no matter who is Prime Minister, this Brexit problem has split the country, has split every party, because every party, you have some people who are for Remain and some who are for Brexit. And this situation worsened when Cameron tried to solve this problem of Remain and Leave by holding this referendum thing, and the country has not recovered. Nothing else is being done. Important things to deal with, the standard of living of the people and so, has been ignored. It's all about this Brexit. Time and millions of money and pounds been used on this Brexit thing.
Well, I just saw on the TV, every time I turn on BBC, you know what that you hear about?
Yes, it's pure that.
Mm-hmm.
Pure Brexit, you know.
It's like in America, every time you turn on
CNN,
it's like in America, every time you turn on CNN, the first name you hear is Trump.
Yes, that's
you can't believe it. CNN, try name Trump, CNN.
It's not about Trump.
Me stop watching Rasta. I mean, every time you turn on the TV, and you turn to CNN, they might have some conversation about Donald Trump to your
You know, it has become, it's a sick obsession, Mota.
Yeah.
It's a sick obsession. So the people don't matter. It is, in other words, then the whole thing become a soap opera about Donald Trump.
Yeah.
And nothing to do with the reality of improving people's life. And it's the same kind of situation happening here with this Brexit business. Like everything else on hold. And you know, as a result of it, a lot of investments, a lot of business not going on as stagnated because people don't know what is going to happen. And you know, in business, you can't proceed in business if the climate is uncertain in terms of how the economic situation is going to go, which is on this whole Brexit thing.
Yeah, yeah.
No, serious situation. You know what I mean?
Well, I'll see where I go and
but see. I'll definitely keep you posted to any future developments and things. But so far, you have 11 of them declaring themselves that they want to be
Prime Minister.
And yet none of them have no solution to this Brexit problem.
Yeah.
None of them.
Mm. All right, Brexit. We have a move.
They don't want to be Prime Minister.
Yeah, we have a move.
Okay. I'll support in Sizzler and all such artists every time. Yeah. Let's go.
Yeah. Speak. Maybe no same upon the radio, eh? Alright, so I'm gonna go and play the music then, since you know how to talk.
Hello?
Yes.
Monta.
Yeah, man.
What?
Cutting edge.
Yeah, man, me listen to you, man. You know, so I'm a fart in me.
So, what do you say?
What?
You're asking them again?
I may try to talk to you about it, you know.
Talk now?
The Trump thing, Donald Trump. Because you understand, say, the man said, boy, Junior can never go over there to get a green card now. You know, if you have English and math subject. You hear anything like that, Moussa?
No, me never hear nothing like that.
Yeah, man, I get to understand.
Where you understand it from? Which way you get it from? The news?
A little birdie told me yesterday.
A little bird?
Yeah, like a birdie called me.
A parrot?
One of my friends called me and told me. You know who that is. You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah, but I don't understand what you say because I ask if it's a little bird because...
No, man, it's a little... I want a lady to tell me.
From foreign, the person there?
No, Jamaica here.
So where she get it from?
I mean, I know where she get it from. Must have
a little bird tell she?
Mm-hmm.
Or no, a bird thing? You know,
if that come true, why? It's like Trump, I want in Jamaica in my country again then.
Me don't know what you say. Me don't know what you say. No, because I know Uncle Jamaican can't read and write.
No, me not say about can't read.
Yeah, then other island too. So that don't necessarily mean say a Jamaica in my get out of the country.
The people who have maths and English now if you get a green card.
Yeah, but when I say I know Uncle Jamaican alone have maths and English.
Yeah, me know that. Me know that a whole heap of nation. Nah,
yeah, but you say no Jamaica. You say no one Jamaica in my country.
Yeah, but me have a thought because...
Trump don't go on white people in my country, not on Jamaica. Yeah, not go Trump,
me know
white
that. People me know that. You know that people in there.
Yeah.
Me understand.
So are you trying to go America now? You don't have no maths or English?
No, so me not trying to go out in country.
Oh. I'm a foreign country still, you know.
Long time now, listen to your family, help you till the mouth, and I first get to talk to you.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah,
the first time you talk to me is to tell us about little bird, I tell you this, and little bird, I tell you that.
Come on, Uta. Because in them time, back couple of days, in the early 90s, we used to have some chest to you, Uta, broke and we used to listen to you.
Okay.
And you know, come up in the 90s, come right up. And you know, one of your favorite songs when we used to listen to.
Which one?
The one where you sing about by the ballot or the bullet by the pilot.
Oh, yeah. Them bandit, you know. Them bandit. Eh? Them bandit have a radio. Them so enough for play. Yeah, man. Them so enough for play.
Well.
Oh, yeah, man. What's them band tune still?
No, I'm never going to look up on YouTube and listen to it.
Yeah, they're on YouTube, but them so enough for play.
Eh?
Yeah.
Never
we don't talk about ballot or bullet, Bible or gun, you know what I mean?
Nah, I did like that one, they moved that truck. Me, almost every day, me used to play that they truck me on the
okay. Car. Okay, all right, sir. Yeah, man, so you done?
Yeah, man, I did like that one, you know?
No, me ask if you're done.
No, sir, we can't done, but me have whole for funds.
Yeah, but you're not, yeah, but we don't have no whole heap of time.
Yeah, that's a true still.
Yeah, so talk about your time.
One moment. When we ever hear from Queen Mother again, Musa?
Me don't know. You don't just hear from her the other day, man.
She don't live in Jamaica, right?
No, she don't live in Jamaica. She tried to come from.
Okay.
You never hear her last month. You never hear her.
Yes, but me that tried to get you to her last month, but me couldn't get you to her last.
She gone a long time. Long time
yeah,
she gone.
Yeah, me know that. But you want to know, sometimes the line, DD and if you don't have enough credit, you can't stay upon it too long.
Okay. But no, you have enough credit, but you can't stay upon it too long.
Yeah, me understand that, but me stay upon it long as much to get you to you.
Yeah, okay.
You understand? So bless up yourself, Muta, and keep on doing your good work, you see?
Yeah, man. Give thanks, Virgin. Right.
Yeah, man. Give thanks.
Yeah.
Classic. Right.
Yeah.
Poor.
People, them just wake up. Yes, EL.
EL up, Muta.
How is it?
Yeah, blessings, man.
Yeah, man, there.
Yeah, man, I wake up and there the whole night. I listen to you there, you know?
Okay.
But so me know you don't really take the call.
Till after a certain time.
But that's all, then we wait until and you
okay.
I take some calls, you know?
Yeah, man.
Yeah, man, so. Well, I'm going to big up to the eye because over years, me I try to follow the eye. And I want to listen to a lot of people that know so the eye is a movie star, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah, because I did that night, I watched. When I move it, I think, I remember my name, I think.
Sankofa?
Yeah, it's Femina Jungle.
I know Jungle, it's Femina, man. Oh, you mean when me young?
Yeah.
I like a baby, I'm a yard, that man, I'm a jungle, I'm a yard, man. The man, come up with the camera, come shoot me up there, I'm a yard, I know.
Yeah, man, and enough people know it's a guy, a movie star as well, you know.
Yeah, we're in a big movie named Sankofa still, one slavery movie.
Yeah, that one, too. Yeah, man, so, and congratulations to your achievement over the years, you know, because it's well deserving, you know.
Yeah, man, give thanks, Virgin. Give thanks.
And I like all your highlights. Africa, the history, tradition. The only one thing we want the people to learn that, we can go back into history, but we have to create a path where we go head up and what we need to change and discover our own.
Right now.
Yeah, right now. Or something for the people and even, you see, like all the dictionary, them, you know, we need to start to put together full one dictionaries, you know. And because a lot of us know the truth, you know. And I'm like, first time I'm in the dark. So, right now, we need to put all the truth together. Some book like all them have all the dictionary where people can go back even years from now and know the truth. Real truth.
They have a Jamaican dictionary, you know.
Yeah?
Yeah, man. They have translate the Bible in a Jamaican language.
But is it the truth?
You mean the Jamaican dictionary?
Yeah.
So what you call the truth dictionary now? Tell me.
No, because you know they brainwash us into believing what they portray. In the books and certain parts
of that dictionary is there to translate. Right, no man, a dictionary is there to give you the meaning of a word.
White God and a lot of us don't really know the truth, you know.
No, but you hear me say no. You talk about truth in a dictionary. Me say a dictionary is a book that gives you the meaning of words. So all that come up in a truth, no one has something.
No. What I mean is when I'm saying the true definition of. For example, if you go into the dictionary right now and you look at the word black, how they define black is not the reality, you know. No, they define the black in a derogatory manner.
Yeah.
And even the word where them they have in the dictionary, until they say you can't find a word in any dictionary no more, them change it. No.
Which word?
First time you could read the word and get the true definition. But
which word?
The same
word?
Way them describe the color of our skin, you know, black people, then put the word together and a lot of people believe it.
Which word?
The word rhythm called nigger.
Yeah, the way Africa say it. In America, this, you know, you can't say it, man. In America, this.
Yeah, yeah.
In America, they might tell you enough to say it, but you can't say it.
Yeah, yeah. Even the word nigger, oh, them define it. You know, them define it like where the worst come after hurt.
Mm.
And then, now, if you look in a dictionary, it only say hen.
Hen?
But I remember reading it and get the definition, hidden definition. What is weed is the black pigmentation, the melanin, them describing.
Yeah. You know, I know, only them in a whole heap of black people don't even know themselves on a level, you know. So, you know,
so,
need some whole
heap of education. So, when we talk about the truth now, you see, all of them look at things that we need to. It need to be available for especially our young generation who searching for the truth.
Okay.
So that's what I mean when we say the truth.
No, I know what you mean when you say the truth is the idea about the dictionary part that I'll try to figure out.
Yeah.
The idea when you say well,
I started off with the dictionary as an example of
what
they put in there when you look forward and the meaning that they give you is not really as far from the truth.
Yeah, okay.
And the paint out white God. And I remember growing up when she had me knock with white. He's been at the church.
It's still about, man. It's still about. You know, it's
yeah,
still about,
and
man.
We bowed all and up with this white thing, you know.
Yeah.
So, and people still do it, man. We were so brainwashed,
yeah, man.
We
still do it, man. I had Christmas. You know, see that part Christmas, man.
Huh?
You know, see, during Christmas and Easter, man, so we still have prayer to white Jesus and white God, man.
Yeah. So, I mean, boy, you help out a lot, man, and, you know, a lot of us, it's just a pity a lot of us are so really narrow-minded and even arrogant. They would never sit down and listen. And when you give them some indication, they go out and try to pick up and look certain books and read them, you know.
And
follow what's going on so they can be on the right track.
Information.
We need to create this year marked the year for 400 years. From then on till now. And it's about time we wise up.
Yeah. All right.
We can't rise up if we don't wise up.
Yeah.
I was about to say it's time to rise up, but so we can be rise up when we don't even know what we're rising up for or how to rise up.
Yeah.
Because we're still lost, we're still in the dark.
Yeah. Rubber move, though, you know. All right, go on, rubber move.
Yeah, man, but it's a pleasure talking to the island.
Yeah, man, give thanks, man. Give thanks, of course. Give thanks.
Hey, yeah, man, so keep up the good work here, sir.
Yeah, man, how is it? The culture there, if you want to see people, if you want to go out of the studio, you're attracted. Whoa, two DJ turn up for one show.
That's wrong.
No, I tell you.
That's wrong.
That's funny. That's really funny. People, two DJ turn up for one show. Matrix in the house and Shade in the house. Shade and the man say, get back in gas money. No, that's funny. It's really funny.
I don't know, man. I'm a virgin, man.
I'll get the mix up. Who get the mix up? Who get it mix up? Tell me.
I don't know.
You never tell him, say, I come to work. You tell him, say, never I come to work.
No,
but... Tell him.
I call back
where? Yeah. I tell him, say, back home.
Yeah, so it means, say, no, say, probably never I'll come or something.
Better get the full understanding.
No, you tell him, say, never I come. If what?
Me suppose,
no. Then are you usually come here, so no way I call that for find out that for.
Yeah.
That is like me there, and I call if I don't if me I go come.
Oh,
yeah, the GT shift, so them now go make it work now.
Yeah.
So you go work tonight again. Well, you are going to know. You're going to work now and then go to sleep. I'll get up back and go work tonight.
Yeah. And then me come in after you when you work for GT later.
Yeah. Can't him used to come after GT? Yeah. Who used to come after GT?
BC.
Oh, so him will come after GT now.
He's supposed to come for him now.
Yeah.
When he
worked
tonight for GT.
Yeah, that's funny, that's funny. I'm glad I didn't have to witness this. I'm glad I didn't have to witness this, right?
I don't know, man.